Look at this image for a moment and think about what you see. Are you all confused? Stay with me for the next few minutes and you'll understand. This is my story. A story I wish to share with you all today. Now you may be wondering, if this is my story, where am I in this picture? Look closer. Do you see the blue girl in the last row? That's me right there. And this is where the story begins. I was born in the late 80s into a lower middle class family. And one thing that my parents wanted me to have since the very beginning was good education. So when it was time, they ensured to enroll me into a good school. There were other girls and boys with whom I started my academic journey. Now, the number of girls and boys in this world is roughly equal. Maybe not 50-50, but the global economy data says it's quite close. And my surroundings at the time were no different. For the most part, through primary and secondary education, the fact that I was a girl did not seem to matter much. Neither did it give me privilege, nor did it take away opportunity. How I wish this could continue. After school, I chose science for my college major. I liked programming, and the idea of building something using code gave me a thrill. So I chose computer science and engineering for my bachelor's program. On the very first day of class, there was a change. A change significant enough for me to take notice. Can you guess? There were fewer same gender peers. 15 of us girls in a class of 60 people. Where had all the other girls gone, I wondered. There is neither evidence of us girls being less intelligent in math or science, nor of us being science phobic. So are STEM fields really biased against girls? Or are we as a society biased in our perception that these STEM fields are more male friendly? Is it a mix of both? I wasn't sure. The World Bank data states that 35% of the STEM graduates are female. And this was matching what I observed. While it did feel different, it was not so bad. Not yet. The difference also got more pronounced during the lab sessions, which involved more group exercises and hands-on activities. In my lab batch of 15 people, there were just two other girls. As part of an IoT lab project, we were all required to submit ideas. After some research, my batchmate, another girl, and I came up with a list of ideas. However, soon enough, we managed to strike out every single one of them. One idea was that of a smart fridge manager. Would that make us look like traditional homemaker material, we thought? Another idea was that of a remote plant monitor. Would that make us seem too soft? Nothing, according to us, was good enough. Among the ideas that the boys proposed, there was a remote-controlled gaming car, a wallet tracker. Those were cool, according to us. Having dropped all of our own ideas, we joined the boys with their projects. That was majority bias kicking in. We were adopting the behavior demonstrated by the majority. Soon, something interesting started to happen. I sensed a shift in my own behavior and actions. I started to feel self-doubt quite frequently, wondering if I was in the wrong place, questioning if I even belonged there. When I had doubts in class, I was hesitant to stand up and ask. By a show of hands, how many of you have heard of the imposter syndrome? Well, while the imposter syndrome is a gender-neutral phenomenon, studies have shown that women are more likely to experience this. A feeling of inadequacy, where we continuously doubt, where we continuously question whether we are qualified enough for something. Studies also show that imposter syndrome can begin at a very early age. And for me back there, doing my computer science bachelor's, that was the onset of imposter syndrome, a mild case of it. Amidst all this, as graduation was approaching, job placements started to take place. Owing to my excellent academic grades, I was allowed to participate in 5 interviews by different companies. While I cleared the technical round in all of them, I failed 2 of these interviews in the very last round. The round which was supposed to be a simple people interaction. More than the fact that I had landed 3 job offers, what bothered me was those 2 failed interviews. So I tried to find out what may have gone wrong. Among the few reasons I managed to list, one was my response to the interviewer's question, "What is your biggest weakness?" And I had responded, "I lack confidence." Then on, I started to pay attention to why I was losing my self-confidence. One of the effects of my imposter syndrome, perhaps? Anyways, that didn't get in the way of me entering the tech industry as a woman. I started my career as a full-stack web developer in a software company. I was filled with curiosity and eagerness to learn. The team I was assigned to had me among 8 other men. In my next level, I observed the same pattern. Most of the team leads were men. Now, the World Economic Forum's gender gap analysis report says that 29% of the STEM workforce is composed of females. On the one hand, this made me feel like an outsider again. On the other hand, it did make me feel somewhat special. I was standing out. Maybe that's not such a bad thing, I thought. All 8 of us were fresh graduates, and we bonded well as one group. 2 months into orientation programs and technical trainings, we were handed our projects. This was the chance for us to prove ourselves, right? And I was determined to give it my best in the first job. Things were going quite well until I started feeling left out. Be it when the male colleagues cracked guy jokes around me, or when they used to stay back late after work, or when they hung out on weekends. They were becoming allies, and I was starting to feel left out again, finding it hard to catch up. I was experiencing FOMO, the fear of missing out, of being left behind. I wondered if I was being excluded from business conversations, of not getting access to the relevant information. Was there proximity bias, where managers offered better opportunities to the male colleagues whom they saw more frequently, with whom they had more personal interactions? Maybe it was all just in my head. All in all, I was feeling less competent being out of the loop. Such workplace FOMO is real and is known to have severe negative implications on employee health, motivation, performance, and success of organizations. For me, the negative self-talk was so powerful, and to overcome this, I started working harder. Delivered each task ahead of time, completed every project with better outcomes. Around the same time, I read about companies that were deploying automation and tech tools to improve representation of women by reducing bias during recruitment. Cool idea, I thought. However, in 2018, Amazon uncovered that their automated recruiting tool ranked male profiles as top talent and suitable for technical positions among a mixed pool of candidates. Now, initially, the recruiters thought that these were the actually qualified candidates, because after all, unlike us humans, machines can't be biased, right? Well, think again. These systems, these algorithms, are trained on a biased historical sample of data accumulated over years. And due to minimal prior evidence that women occupy technical positions, these systems learned that it is unlikely or less likely to also happen in the future. So relying on technology alone to eliminate these biases was not going to be enough. As a matter of fact, aren't we humans the ones building technology? And if half of us are not even contributing, imagine what the outcomes could look like. Now, we all use Google on a daily basis, don't we? I want you all to try something today. Search for person and look at the results that show up. A simple search for person reveals that most of the results are male-oriented. Even though, as we all know, person is a gender-neutral term. Now, I'm not saying that these algorithms are not good, but they are all designed based on large-scale data sets. And any inherent biases in such data are only bound to be transferred. But wait, it's not only to get rid of biases. Social diversity also is known to enhance creativity, problem-solving skills, innovation capability, and leads to higher quality scientific research, all of which are vital for organizations today. So what is all of this trying to tell us? That we must take more initiative, and I wanted to do my part. So I started focusing my energy on two aspects. Not just to have a gender-balanced workforce for the sake of optics or for the sake of tokenism, but because a more representative workforce, I believe, can lead to problems being tackled from a variety of viewpoints. One, I started working on myself, building up confidence, picking up the courage to voice my opinions in front of male colleagues, taking ownership of my own thoughts and ideas. I pushed myself out of the comfort zone every opportunity I got. And two, working on enabling others. I started mentoring girls from my school and colleges, joined initiatives working for underrepresented groups and for empowering them struggling to enter the tech field. I coached female founders venturing into their entrepreneurship journey. Through all of this, I had the support of several male colleagues, both peers as well as among higher-ups, who were strong advocates for workplace diversity. Such male allies demonstrated that it is a win-win for everyone and set the right example for me. All of this also motivated me to become a team leader, a people manager, so that I could be that ally for those around. What's next, you might ask? Well, the World Economic Forum states that 12% of women occupy top positions and C roles in technology companies. But let's take a minute to understand what it is that companies look at while hiring for the top, for those who will be the ultimate decision makers. Psychology studies published in 2019 and 2021 suggest that women are less likely to be promoted into top positions as compared to men. But that's not it. These studies also go on to explain why. Women have to prove that they can succeed in a certain position before being promoted into it, whereas men are frequently promoted for their perceived potential. For women, it is proof of past and current performance, whereas for men, it is future leadership potential. Now, why this bias? While few may argue that this allows women to be more prepared and more competent, don't you think this puts immense pressure on us to work harder in order to move up the ladder? We're approaching the end, and that's me. Trying to break the biases at every phase. A few from others, and a few biases of my own. I've come this far, and data tells me moving up from here is going to be even harder. Nevertheless, I'm up for the challenge. And with that, I'd like to thank you all for being a wonderful audience and wish you a great day ahead.